Penguin Random House Audio presents The American Political Tradition and the Men Who Made It by Richard Hofstadter, with a foreword by Christopher Lash, read for you by Kaleo Griffith. Foreword. Even though his career was cut short in its prime, leaving us immeasurably impoverished by the loss, Richard Hofstadter left a full and rounded body of work, not merely one or two important books, which is the best that most historians can hope for. Each of Hofstadter's books bore an important relation to its predecessors and to those that were to come. None, accordingly, can be seen in isolation from the others. Hofstadter's imagination never rested for long, and his thought ranged widely, embracing political, social, and cultural history. He was impatient with such distinctions, and extending to all periods of American history. Yet his ideas constantly returned to certain central preoccupations stated at the outset of his career. A continuing encounter with the progressive tradition, the tradition on which he and most other intellectuals had been reared, as he put it in the introduction to The Age of Reform, but in which he found much to criticize, informs all Hofstadter's work and provides a direct link, for example, between the American political tradition, first published in 1948, and the progressive historians, which came out 20 years later. The continuity of Hofstadter's altogether remarkable career is all the more apparent if one remembers that his first published essay, appearing in 1938, dealt with Charles A. Beard's interpretation of the Civil War, and that other early writings included essays on Frederick Jackson Turner, on V.L. Parrington, and once again on Beard, the same writers to which he returned toward the end of his life. Footnote. The Tariff Issue on the Eve of the Civil War, American Historical Review, 1938, pages 50 through 55. Parrington and the Jeffersonian Tradition, Journal of the History of Ideas, 1941, pages 391 through 400. Turner and the Frontier Myth, American Scholar, 1949, pages 433 through 443. Beard and the Constitution, American Quarterly, 1950, pages 195 through 213. Hofstadter's lifelong engagement with the progressive historians immediately tells us something about the American political tradition, the witty, caustic, daring book that first brought Hofstadter's writing to general attention. That book took shape in a confrontation not only with liberalism and politics, but with liberal historiography, and specifically with the three towering figures who had exercised such a powerful influence on the generation of historians immediately preceding Hofstadter's own, and for that matter, on Hofstadter himself, as he tells us in The Progressive Historians. Having taken up American history in the 30s, under the inspiration that came from Charles and Mary Beard's The Rise of American Civilization, just as another generation was to take up American history under the inspiration that came from the American political tradition, Hofstadter quickly became dissatisfied with the distortions and simplifications associated with the interpretation of American history as a continuing conflict between antagonistic forms of property, more crudely, as a conflict between the people and the interests. The Progressive Historians, Roman numeral page 14. By the middle 30s, this progressive or populist interpretation of the American past had lost whatever critical content it might have once possessed and had become identified with a resurgence of American cultural chauvinism, a tiresome celebration of the American past, its indigenous traditions of popular radicalism, the crude vitality of its popular culture, and the national regeneration allegedly in progress under the New Deal. The progressive interpretation of American history, in other words, had helped to bring into being a literature of hero worship and national self-congratulation, which it was one of the stated purposes of the American political tradition to deflate. The most curious aspect of this degeneration of a once critical tradition of thought into a form of cultural nationalism is that it occurred under left-wing auspices. The emergence of the Popular Front in 1935 and the Communist Party's reassuring announcement that communism could be regarded as 20th century Americanism had given the signal for the repatriation of a generation of alienated intellectuals. Aestheticism, anti-Americanism, and the cultivation of the inner life went abruptly out of fashion, along with the super-revolutionism of third-period communism, which had dismissed the reform tradition in the United States as petty bourgeois reaction and the New Deal as incipient fascism. Progressivism and the progressive interpretation of history underwent a revival, and the search for native traditions of politics and culture became a minor industry. Van Wyck Brooks, formerly an astringent critic of American culture, embarked on his nostalgic evocations of the 19th century in Makers and Finders. The debunking biographical essays of the 20s and early 30s gave way to filio-pietistic commemorations of popular heroes. Sandburg's Lincoln, Van Doren's Franklin, Freeman's Lee, in which the sheer accumulation of empirical detail served to lull readers into an acquiescent, appreciative mood. Archibald MacLeish, always a reliable weather vane, forsook the avant-gardism of his Poundian phase and threw down what he described as loud-mouthed, disrespectful, horse-laughing challenges to those who tell us poetry is pure, and written about the feeling of being dreadfully alone. Other poets responded eagerly to his call for public speech. Thomas Hart Benton underwent a similar conversion, moving from New York to Missouri and from abstract art to populist neo-regionalism, proclaiming the death of the great cities. Frank Lloyd Wright and Lewis Mumford exalted regionalism over urbanism. Instead of clinging to the sardonic funereal towers of metropolitan finance, intoned the latter, ours to march out to newly plowed fields, to create fresh patterns of political action, to alter for human purposes the perverse mechanisms of our economic regime, to conceive and to germinate fresh forms of human culture. Footnote: Our age is rich in political and spiritual conversions, wrote Morton Dowan Zabel in a fierce polemic against MacLeish. The Poet on Capitol Hill, Partisan Review, January through February, 1941, pages 7, 9. See also Meyer Shapiro on Benton, Populist Realism, January 1937, pages 53 through 57, and on Mumford, Looking Forward to Looking Backward, July 1938, pages 12 through 24. An important essay on the 30s by Warren Sussman, The 30s. In Lorman Ratner and Stanley Coben, editors, The Development of an American Culture, 1970, pages 179 through 218, points out that the popularization of the concept of culture, in the sense of a whole way of life, organically rooted in the everyday experience of the folk, provides an important clue to one of the overriding intellectual preoccupations of the decade, the search for native political traditions and for the roots of an authentic popular culture. The most effective criticism of the excesses and absurdities associated with this latest and much acclaimed American Renaissance came from the left, like the Renaissance itself, notably from the group of intellectuals affiliated with or close to Partisan Review. This magazine broke away from the Stalinist literary movement in 1936 and reemerged a year later as an independent journal, Marxist in its general intellectual outlook, anti-Stalinist in its politics, and resolutely opposed to the subordination of art and culture to the political needs of the moment. The Partisan Review critics charged neo-populist writers with ransacking the past, as Richard Chase put it in an attack on Mumford, that is, with conducting armed raids on history, so as to build up an ersatz cultural tradition, a mythical organic community. Without denying the connection between culture and politics, or the need for historical criticism of both, these intellectuals drew a distinction between history conceived as a usable past, the conception promoted by Brooks, Beard, and Carl Becker, and history seen as an accumulation of experience, between using the past and assimilating it. Just as children do not use their mothers but are formed by them. So, they insisted, each generation is formed by its predecessors. And the problem for historical analysis is not to invent a past relevant to the needs of the present, but to become critically conscious of these influences. Footnote. Richard Chase, The Armed Obscurantist, Partisan Review, Summer 1944, pages 346 through 348. William Phillips and Philip Rov, Some Aspects of Literary Criticism, Science and Society, Winter 1937, page 217. For the concept of a usable past, see Van Wyck Brooks, On Creating a Usable Past, Dial, April 11th, 1918, pages 337 through 341. And Carl Becker's well-known essay, Every Man His Own Historian, 1931. The position formulated by the Partisan Review critics implied an emphatic rejection of the progressive historiography of Parrington, Beard, and Becker, and also, it should be noted, of Frederick Jackson Turner's frontier theory of American history. American progressivism, these writers correctly perceived, was historically bound up with the optimistic idea of an expanding American world, a vision of limitless space that idealizes an earlier stage of popular rule as a norm of democracy constantly threatened and regained. Footnote. Meyer Shapiro, Populist Realism, Partisan Review, January 1937, pages 55 through 56. Not only the superficiality of progressivism, but the radical discontinuity of American culture, it seemed to these writers, derived from the ceaseless search for new beginnings of which the frontier had provided the most durable set of images, the flight from complexity, the flight from the past, the belief that the past is an encumbrance that can painlessly be discarded in the restless search for a better future. It is not difficult to recognize in this critique of progressive political culture and its Marxist offshoots of the 30s the central themes of Hofstadter's early work. Like the Partisan Review critics, Hofstadter had been drawn to Marxism and to the economic interpretation of history, only to witness at close range their degeneration into an official culture. As Meyer Shapiro put it in his polemic against Benton, local in content, national in scale. Personally, as well as temperamentally, Hofstadter was close to the PR group. Shapiro, Chase, F.W. Dupuy, Lionel Trilling, Eric Bentley, and C. Wright Mills were his colleagues.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.